So good evening, everyone. I'm very pleased to be with you, and I would like to thank very sincerely the Iran Heritage Foundation, not only for inviting me tonight to present some brief researches about the visual arts of Iran in the 60s and 70s mainly, but also for allowing me to conduct some researches that I began with Tate Modern Museum. As you would have understood already, I'm not an English speaking fluent, so you will have to bear my French accent all along, but I will do my best to be comprehensible, but I will have to do also with your indulgence on that matter. The title of my presentation being The Cosmogonies of Oil Traffic and Visual Culture in Modern Iran. Maybe I shall go back to the title here so you can read it for a second, because I'd like to elaborate a little on this title before going in depth. So the cosmogonies of oil traffic and visual culture in modern Iran. I will explore this notion of cosmogony further on in this lecture. As for the expression oil traffic specifically, I don't mean that what I should have basically called oil economy or oil industry is explicitly and entirely illicit by using the word traffic. And the illicit behaviors and phenomenon obviously existed throughout the history of oil industry and the Western powers' geopolitics regarding the Middle East or even Africa. And as for the Middle East, Iran in first position. So here you are faced with an oil map, oil economy and industry development mapping in the late 50s, which is a crucial time, as you know, for the history of oil industry in Iran. So probably the most memorable of those illicit episodes remain the American 1953 coup against the nationalist Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh, and surely the best preface to the story I'm about to tell. Or by way of preface, I could have also begun with this quote by the inevitable Iran historian Ervand Abrahamian, who estimates that, I quote, oil nationalization was for Iran what national independence was for many former colonies in Africa, Asia, Latin America, and the Caribbean, end quote. It's from his recent book entitled The Coup. But anyway, this operation of remapping history through the relations of oil history and visual arts history that I'm about to sketch here this evening echoes, in my view, the further connotations of the word traffic, drawing beyond illicitness the ideas of circulation and transport, especially overseas and lands, not only for exchanging goods and securing a market, but also for connecting places, nations, actually, and people's experiences. Nevertheless, I shall not get involved so much in revealing the political unconscious of oil this evening, but more its visual unconscious or its unexpected crossroads with modern visual culture and the visual arts, mainly from the 60s and the 70s, that is to say, the post-Mossadegh era. Thus, let me clarify right away that the tremendous efforts and establishments made by the last Pahlavi dynasty, and of course the Empress Farah Dibah, in favor of the arts, which means settling biennials, raising collection, building museum, etc., etc., may be the tip of the iceberg, as you say in English, or just one side of the story. Indeed, one of my aims here will be to demonstrate that crossroads between the geopolitics of oil and certain aesthetic trends in art history ramify by definition through an undermined or underground system of representation and iconography. Something like a traffic of images, taking history through a visual process of remapping, reconnecting, and eventually re-editing. Just as the Nouvelle Vague filmmaker Jean-Luc Godard would lately present himself as an image dealer, I would like to begin the story of this visual traffic in oil by returning to someone who acted so even earlier than Godard, namely Chris Marker. Prior to his path in cinema and moving images, Chris Marker collaborated in the 1950s, that is to say the Mossad der era, with the famous French publisher Le Seuil as the artistic director and graphic designer of an innovative travel guides collection entitled Petite Planète, Small Planet. And in the issue number 13 on Iran, and at the last page, Chris Marker edits an original montage with a very special iconographic method in its time. He reveals a full double-page juxtaposition between a panoramic photograph of Persepolis ruins and another panoramic photograph of an oil refining plant, probably that of the city of Obodon, the largest one at the time. The highly avant-garde iconographic gesture may prove to be more than a simple juxtaposition. Thus, a visual clock, which little and big hands swing towards heterogeneous temporalities. As a basic clock swing, within the same unit of space and time, Marker places ancient conquests of or the devastation of Persepolis by Alexander the Great, hand in hand with modern capitalism and geopolitics. As if to imply that the antique struggles between the Persians and foreign powers is ongoing in new forms. For the Iranians, the 1950s represent both the peak and decline of the workers' struggle against the twofold power, internal and external, exerted almost naturally on the country's energy and human resources since the establishment in 1901 of the William Knox Darcy Concession, first British exploiter to manage Iranian oil, until the monopoly of companies like the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company, AIOC. The 1953 American coup against the nationalist Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh, in spite of the occasional expulsion of foreign companies and the more balanced distribution of wealth agreements, proved to be a preliminary wobble in a surge of popular sovereignty. In Chris Marker's montage, the ancient ruins appear to lie in wait for the modern ruins, ruins that became later reality with the destruction of the Obadan oil refinery during the Iran-Iraq War, an awkward confirmation of the montage prophecy, since Chris Marker did this montage in the late 50s, far before the Iran-Iraq War. Another potential clock swing through the historical layers is nearly 15 years after Marker sets up his time machine, the 1971 oil crisis in benefit of Iran is supposed to emancipate the country from the warm waters of the Third World and introduce it to the fresh garden of the industrialized and capitalist nations, which Chris Marker again documents prophetically or in advance by suggesting how the glorious and flourishing imperial era could resurrect through the black gold produced in Iranian refineries. But the clock swing eventually goes further than Reza Shapahlavi's golden dreams of an imperial modern progress and supremacy. By use of an antique and modern, or erection and ruins, or rise and fall dialectics, or one should say a rise and fall traffic instead of a dialectics, this iconographic re-editing hints at a fair historical curse, that no ideal of progress in a civilization, process or attempt to transcend the value of culture goes without a paradoxical sympathy for destruction and potential for war. Eventually, the harsh anachronism of Marker's montage sheds light on the 1950s Iran like a Freudian psychological structure, namely the superego, or the authority which guards against the effusion of emancipatory urges, the authority of power or of control, in short. The superego of oil acts through the persistence and survival of the antique landscape faced with industrial conquest. Like witnessing the movement of history's pendulum, depending on whether the columns of Achaemenid temples replace oil refining columns and vice versa, or the economic process of modernization, which is usually imposed by above, hinders or fuels the poetic surge of modernity, usually beginning underground or in the margins. There I wanted to bring some cinema example from Ebrahim Golestan in the field of pre-revolution Iranian cinema. Both in literature and in cinema, you have a lot of scenes describing the arrival of oil company planes and cargoes in the ancient regions of Khuzestan, including archaeological sites of temples which go back to the Zoroastrians, the Achaemenids, and the Parthian Empire, like in the Masjid Soleiman site. The writer and film director Ebrahim Golestan provided a memorable example of this in his film, his documentary film, Mojo Marjano Khara, The Wave, the Coral, and the Granite, which is a documentary produced in 1962, describing the installation of oil pipelines from the town of Arrojari to the island of Kharg.
In the realm of the sea, there is no desire, no seeking out. Oblivious of the torments of thought, life follows instinct and submits to fate, the fate that is the ever-falling sediment from a higher world. There is a coral island lying in the sun, Kharg. Kharg had been found suitable to become a marine terminal for the export of crude oil from oil fields on the mainland of Iran. By air and sea, the workforce came to the island, and the tools and provisions. To make a firm foundation for the jetty and its equipment, piles over 130 feet long were driven down into the seabed. In the hours of leisure,
okay, maybe we shall stop there. Ibrahim Golestan's oil industry movies that were commissioned movies by the oil companies themselves usually were both typical and atypical. They were typical from that era of commissioned industrial and commercial movie that happened to be done by the ones who were to become the great writers or filmmakers of modern Iran. So typical of that economic context, and also atypical in its poetic film form. So what happens is that Ebrahim Golestan worked officially for the Anglo-Iranian oil company. And during this period, he will develop by himself or against himself, he will develop some sort of tension through a very peculiar position of his, which we could call the author under contract, which is a paradox. I'm bringing the notion of author, which is the one who has no contract, the one who follows his ideas, but in fact also follows a commission and some expectation from the oil company who commissioned the movie. So I would simply call that the author under contract, which is against nature in a way. And he would continually both honoring and subverting the commission. So for example, in A Fire from 61, he would visually subvert the commission in the sense that this episode of a pipeline which is burning, it's an industrial accident, so the pipeline burns and all the workers get together for several days and nights without sleep in order to get the pipeline fixed and stop the burning. And Ebrahim Golestan would take this occasion of an accident, so something that's not really in favor or in celebration of the oil industry, but shows more the failures or the defaults of the oil economy. And most of all, by using the pattern of fire almost as an abstract painting pattern, because at some point in the film, the screen is burning, the image itself becomes so contaminated by the visual and sensitive power of the fire that it takes you completely out of the context itself in favor of a sort of experimental, cinematic, and almost phenomenological image of fire that overwhelms the spectator of the film. But in Mojo Marjan or Khara, it would be more narratively and linguistically that Ebrahim Golestan would subvert the commission. Because as you heard, in A Fire, the voiceover is an American speaking, very established way of speaking for American documentaries. While in Mojo Marjan or Khara, Ebrahim Golestan is in Farsi. Mojo Marjan Okhara is in Farsi and has a much more epic, poetic, classic poetry-inspired way of narrating, this time not an accident, but the welfare and celebration of how the oil industry, machines and mechanicals install themselves and sort of occupy the territory and transform the landscape, basically. So that's what I'm interested in. And as for this transformation of the landscape through the bodies of the workers, you got some feeling of this. Where I'm going at is that Golestan converts a balanced situation between his poetic vocation for image and his indistinct commitment within production and dominant economic structures. He converts this balanced situation into a new cosmogony. So now here we are with this strange term that I used in my title of cosmogony. I'll go with the definition, very basic definition, of a structural tale or narrative system or physical equation, mainly about the birth and evolution of the universe or that of the solar system, in which mythological and scientific theories can meet. It also suggests, the term cosmogony, a wider process, that is to say, an anthropomorphic, a human-like or bodily, an anthropomorphic transformation of nature or the astronomy. The most renowned cosmogonies are stories of how the universe took shape in negotiation between men, gods, and the stars, come from the Greco-Roman, ancient Egypt, but also the Mesopotamian. Obviously, every civilization, at least ancient civilization, has its own narrative of how the universe became the universe. And what I'd like to do here is to give, inspired by the artist I'm talking about, is to give a slight political color to this very obsolete notion of cosmogony, also by reconnecting to what it normally should forbid: industry, economy, and mechanical forces. So a cosmogonic dimension pervades the titles of the film produced at this time by Golestan, like A Fire, and by his alter ego Furuch Farrukhzad, who did a film called Water and Fire, also in 61, and more particularly in The Wave, the Coral, and the Granite, Mojo, Marjan, or Khara, the arrival of the huge oil company machines is preceded by a camera diving in the coral microcosm and primitive aquatic fauna, ready to be violently taken away by the metallic jaws of industrial progress. In this introductory scene, Golestan uses a mean of expression that will be a sort of trademark, a dull, almost monotone voice intended to make all the classic poetry resound mezzo voce in a modern meditation about nature, man, and technology. Then the brutality of the images that were also applicable to A Fire gradually takes over from the secret voice of the poet in the profanation of the bowels of the earth, or the earth become a body, and the earth, the rocks, the landscape, and even the fire, the water, the wind, Otash, Bod, Hawk, come to a sort of agglomeration or coagulation of elements through an anthropomorphic bodily dimension in which the bodies of the workers contribute, but not only, also the landscape itself as a sort of bodily expression. In fact, what is even more interesting is the vocation of the modern author cannot feign its camouflage beneath the guise of classical poetry or the gallant story of Khosro and Shirin told by Nezomi 12th century. Because of a certain scene in Mojo Marjan Okhara by Golestan, where the cranes and the tractors with their toothed mouth and their superhuman arms grab the earth and pick up and push back tons of granite stones to build a jetty opening out to the Persian Gulf, because to get more efficient in the oil production, you not only had to unveil the surfaces of the rocks in order to go extract from below, but you obviously also had to conquest the sea, the water space, in order to go beyond that first rocky geological step. And so this is very interesting that Golestan produces that reminiscence of Khosro and Shirin, precisely the scene where Farhad, Khosro's rival, pulls up granite stones one by one, Sange Khara, that reappear in the film title, to release a waterway and enable his beautiful beloved Shirin to bathe at the foot of this castle. A gesture of love, as well as a gesture for industrializing the landscape in battling the elements and standing between the elements. Pile up the stones, shovel the earth, penetrate the sea, all cosmogonic gestures now accomplished by the oil workers with the help of machines that diligently fight like an artificial lung grafted onto the rocky landscape. So in fact, where my conclusion about the contribution of Ebrahim Golestan to this story I'm trying to tell here is more or less the story of the oil as being the black gold and a calamity, both ways paradoxical, for a population who, by exporting its main resources, imports a double risk of political malediction and natural disaster. I would like to read to you a very short landscape description that I found in a book that I won't mention the title now. It's a book from the late 50s, written by an English gentleman who did a very apparently accurate and very exhaustive historical survey of how it began with the William Knox Darcy concession in 1901 until the late 50s, as for the expansion of the British oil companies in Iran. So I read it. From the summit stretching away to the final unassailable fortress of the Zagros, they would have seen an endless geological litter of jagged foothills. The surface of the earth here is topsy-turvy, as though some great cataclysm had turned it up on end. Over millions of years, as the earth shrank, its crust crumpling like the skin of an aging apple, the weaker parts gave way, and here ranges of mountains have been folded as though between the jaws of a giant vise. These were the Thym Tar hills in which oil traditionally was to be found, end quote. So what's interesting in that landscape description is the anthropomorphic dimension, the giant vise, the footsteps, is the layers of the rocky landscape that have to be unveiled one by one to achieve the extraction of oil, and that sort of very atmospheric and what I should call a cosmogonic feeling of the landscape under the influence of oil attraction or extraction, that is in fact raising a whole new experience of the landscape and of nature itself, which reveals the very paradoxical and the sort of superego, in a Freudian way, if you will, of the aesthetic experience of extracting oil. It exists in book descriptions, in Ebrahim Golestan films. There is an aesthetic experience of oil extraction. So something strange, but it exists. Let me just check the time. I'd like also to quote a few fragments from classical poetry, very briefly. For example, from the Khamseh Nezami, Ruz-e-khosh omr be shab-e-khosh resid, khak be-bad, ab be-atash resid. Which I'm very sorry to have to translate because it's almost an insult to translate this, but happy day of existence returns to a happy night, dirt returns to wind, and water to fire. Or for example, in Masnavi e Molavi, Bado, Khako, Abo, Atash, Bandeand, Bamano to Morde, Baha, Zendeand, which means wind and dirt, water and fire are creatures. As true as we become dead, they awake in truth. And finally, from Ghaznavi, Gar ab o atash andar khalafe u kushand, zebad o khak binand, keifar atash o ab, which could be translated as soon as water and fire would grab him, wind and dirt will reign supreme on water and fire. So, unfortunately, I don't have the time to elaborate on the analysis of these fragments, but you see how the four elements are in a sort of cosmogonic symphony raised by almost all the important classic poetry of Iran. It's a commonplace. You could find that synthetic and simultaneous use of these elements in classic poetry everywhere. It's not difficult to find. What I'm trying to do is to understand how it sort of reappears strangely, transformatively, in the context of the cinema and painting of the 60s and the 70s. If I take back from this montage of Chris Marker, in order to endure this gap between modernization and modernity, economic power and poetic power, if you will, we need to confront those antiquity dreams of His Majesty and His kingdom of anachronistic hope and despair with those of His degenerate heir, we could even say His evil prince, namely the painter and sculptor Bahman Mohassez. Here he is in Rome, Italy, reminiscent city of the great empire, same city where the Shah escaped during the riots that overthrew Mossadegh. We are in the beginning of the 1970s, and we found Mohassez struggling in a foundry to get properly done his sculpture of the Shah and the royal family, actually commissioned by Faradiba. This rare image of Mohassez, most unknown and unseen sculpture, reveal his ambiguous feelings towards power and establishment, researching power and the honorary benefits from such a symbolic commission, and at the same time proving to be uniquely iconoclastic mind. Mohassez is, after all, the author of the most provocative sculpture in the public space of Iran, his famously recorded fauna musician brandishing his flute and his genitals graciously in the wind, erected on a pedestal in front of the city theater, Théâtre Shahr. The ultimate outburst of Mohassez's deep love for the Greek mythology and the antiquity or the Renaissance golden age for intelligence, poetry, music, refinement, humanism, but also lust and manifestations of the flesh. Certainly a sign of Farah Dibbah's own commitment, protective and patronizing supporter of Mohassez. But how could she protect the royal family sculpture from the king's own outraged reaction in front of what he felt as an insulting image of himself, dismissing Mohassez's piece of bravery in the waste and dust of art history? Is it the anxious look of the Shah, his physical split from the Empress and the child, or altogether summarized in the shaking hand that grabs the cape furiously, that made him order the confinement of the royal family sculpture? In Mitra Farahani's documentary, 50 Holes from Happiness, you maybe saw, Mohassez himself, who by the way is recorded by several witnesses wearing a cape in his glorious youth, confessed pretentiously, "I had made a monster out of the Shah." No doubt he was then having a friendly thought for Goya, who in its time was both serving as painter of the Spanish court and denouncing Inquisition atrocities in his works. Subversion of power from the inside. Beyond the love and hate relationship between the king and its evil prince, namely Bahman Mohassez, what seals their distorting mirror relation is definitely their dream of antiquity or seemingly renaissance of a golden age, either regarding the Greeks, the Italians, or the Persians, either from a sovereign ruler point of view or a sovereign fine artist point of view, because Bahman Mohassez was a sort of sovereign in his own way. But their fantasies, convergence in anachronistic tendency, stop here. The sovereign ruler, on the one hand, cultivates extreme schizophrenia, dreaming of westernizing Iran through the Persian mythology, aiming restlessly at civilizing his own people, celebrating an industrialized and capitalist economy, again, even in dreams. On the other hand, the sovereign fine artist unconditionally threatens his viewer with what he calls the condemnation of the being, la condamnation de l'être. As we hear him say, interviewed in Ahmad Farouri's 1967 documentary for the national TV, financed obviously by the cultural services of the court. Submerged by a profound and cruel reflection on the existentialist post-war crisis of the being, la crise de l'être, Mohassez's depiction of the body, the one he will oppose to the glorious and statuary body of the king, ends in a decomposed and miserable entity. He calls the individual plunged in the experience of modernity a bodily assemblage, un assemblage corporel, that of the post-World War II tragedy of mankind. Thus, the remapping of Iran's social history is also at stake when the imperialist dreams of antiquity were to become a nightmare in its Mohassez version. Faced to each other, the absurd mimicry of the Shah's 2,500 years celebration of 1971, embodied by a Persian naval ship and soldiers, all fake obviously and staged, leading the ultimate procession in front of the world's ruler and generals. And on the other side, Mohassez's cynical mockery of a body without identity or destination, out of his boat, itself out of the water, and probably out of the world, horizonless. Paradoxically enough, while the Shah pursues his colonial deed and ideal of westernization, or to put it bluntly, while he pursues his Persian-American dream until his diplomatic wedding with the Carter administration, Mohassez chose his moment for mocking the Americanization of the bodies themselves, and somehow the mechanization of the bodies. Riding lavishly a motorcycle when you don't have fingers, hands, or feet to actually drive, when you barely remain a bodily assemblage of ruined or petrified disjointed muscles in a sign of your allegiance to brands such as Coca-Cola. Except that in his large-scale painting exhibited in Shiraz International Venue of 1974 that you see here, the name of the famous brand has been Italianized into Cazzo Cola, the word cazzo meaning literally the genitals. Yet, his meticulous and incisive dissection of the human body owes its visual efficiency to what I shall call a cosmogony. Mohassez's cosmogony reveals more firmly in the middle of the 60s, when the artist returned to Tehran after a long stay in Rome, where he studied sculpture. His ability to sculpt the canvas soon echoes his desire to paint bodies as organic ruins. Back from the post-fascist and genuine antiquity of Rome to the utopian and cosmopolitan antiquity of Tehran and, in fact, Persepolis. Sustained by an intense aesthetic dialogue with works of Henry Moore and Alberto Giacometti, Mohassez initially created those characters nicknamed Bidastopa, the footless and handless, nicknamed by posterity. A group of crawling effigies that stagnate always near the seashore in a world flagrantly deprived of God or any master, if not the will of their own creator, this latter never hesitating on several occasions to destroy his own works. The handless and footless, with a rather skeletal appearance, featuring the spirit of vanitas, or rather extraterrestrial, featuring the spirit of monsters, represent us, reduced to fragments of almost lifeless stones, sang, and other materials bordering the organic or almost organic. They represent an act of violence as Mohassez decapitates, dismembers, disfigures. Bored to death on vague sorts of land or abandoned beaches, we imagine them fallen from an ancient mythological world and having landed on the cold sand of modernity, where myth now peter out. A world transecting the sky, the sea, and the earth by three hermetic, flat, and monochromatic areas without decor or artifice, in which the falling of the bodies produces the present ruins. It's an impure cosmogony of oil traffic and visual culture in Iran, 60s and 70s, which is replying to a modernity that is both destructive and a source of renewal or renaissance, subjecting the new man of industrial progress to the judgment of the elders, those of the mythological world, produces political events like natural disaster. What I mean is that in that cosmology, in that system of representation, political events or catastrophes are represented as natural catastrophes. So Mohassez's obsession for the dehumanizing power of machines in a world without theological reference goes undoubtedly pessimistic and cynical. Mocking the Shah's dreams of glorious antiquity, he makes an unexpected use of antiquity by creating a cosmogony of his own. The stone, the sea, and the sand go through a process of coagulation, eventually depriving mankind from any vitality or blood, and nevertheless giving to his figures this sovereign strength that seems to look forward at blowing up the canvas. I'm almost done. Eventually, Mohassis' cosmogony narratively stands out with his obsession for ecological dramas and oil slick, Marais Noir, in the first place, which was really affecting deeply his soul. As he say in this aphorism, after all, I quote Mohassis, "What else painting is capable of in a world without, in a world with a sky without birds, a sea without fish, and a wood without beasts," end quote. The fish out of the sea or on the edge of the sea, whose destiny is rather clear, not only shows a dead end as for its own life, but also tends to a cosmogonic dimension as an earthly fish, constantly reappearing and rejected by the sea as the oil is rejected or the fire is rejected by the land, the fish is rejected by the sea, as an invisible wave directed to us, fulfilling the spectator with the spectacle of his own bare, unfitting presence to the world and finitude. Each of Mohassis' fish indicates how disaster seems to be lying in wait at every moment. As far as the sculptures explicitly entitled Oil Slick, like the one on the left, and beside is one of the only real life portraits that Mohassis did, is the portrait of Mohammad Mossadegh. Those sculptures of the oil slick were the fish and the bird petrified by oil, emerging as mutant vanitas and questioning the sculptural potential of oil itself. That's the same that when I was speaking about the aesthetic experience of the extraction of oil, Mohassis also, in his sculpture of oil-slicked animals, is looking at the sculptural potential of oil, or the aesthetic potential of the catastrophe, which is a very common notion of the romantic Kantian conception of the sublime, if you think about it. His authentic hope and despair with the Mossadegh ideals of the 1950s go beyond Iran's modern oil history. They draw properly Iran's oil visual traffic and unconscious. The popular will of national sovereignty, hindered by geopolitical and natural resources issues, is overcome by his strong desire to challenge real and imaginary geographical borders alongside the borders of the canvas or of the pedestal. The counter-geography of oil that since the end of the 1960s has accidentally spilled onto the Spanish or Greek coasts with the oil slicks revive Mohassis' desire for Picasso and Goya, his love of the Renaissance, the study of physiognomy, though he would mainly dismember the human figure. He would love the study of physiognomy, the Renaissance study of physiognomy, and at the same time, he would only and perpetuously dismember and disfigure his characters. Or that of ancient Greeks, whom he also admires for their statuary art, even if he would ultimately make any sculptural attempt for erection crumble and fall, preferring to the art of statuary what he called himself anti-statue. Mohassis used to say, "I don't make sculpture, I make anti-statue." Mohassis' sculptures, which often seem to levitate in gravity zero or detach themselves from any earthly basis, are physically balanced by the oil slicks which reorient sculpture in the waste and dust of history. So on the one hand, this levitation, the search for the grace that Mohasis had mainly in sculpture, because he wasn't acting like this in his painting, and the balance with the oil slick thematic, bringing the animals to the ground. The formless and irrepressible function of oil in Mohasis' cosmogony is that of repressing the graceful and sublime feeling that past Renaissance gives him in the wait for future Renaissance, backlashed since the Mossadegh era. Mohasis' violent beheading of the crowned head's lineage and the monarchic storytelling is at the same time a re-heading or a new beginning for history where it had stopped through what I shall call a natural history of political catastrophes. Thank you very much.